Good afternoon. My name is Tom Ostrowski. I work here at CERN in the BIMS department, controls group. We do control systems, low-level hard real-time equipment for that drives the beam in the accelerators. And today I wanted to show you a small footprint RISC-V core that we recently developed. So, why did we do that? We have a number of projects that use software CPUs, and so far we have been using the LM32 architecture as the software from Lattice. However, despite being open source, it's licensed under BSD license. It has some very dangerous clauses, for instance, export limitations, which makes it questionable whether we can host the source code of the LM32 via BSD license authorized in a public repository. So that's one of those. Then there are other architectures popular, such as NIST and ARM, but they are patented. And if you try to implement your software, especially an efficient one, you will more or less will get legal trouble. There are other FPGA vendor provided cores, such as Microblaze, NIOS, but our designs need to be portable. We have users that which we provide service, and they use both Altair and Xilinx FPGA, sometimes Lattice. So portability is a must. Access to the source code as well. Then there is a number of free open source CPU designs. Most of them were really thought for booting Linux. So they are quite big and they don't scale well for deeply embedded applications. So we found out about the RISC-V about a year ago. It's a very promising instruction set, very, very well designed. But at the moment when we started the URV project, there was no Verilog HDL implementation. I like VSO, it's a very nice language, but as I mentioned in my comment before, we have a lot of clients that use VHDL or Verilog, primarily VHDL, and they might not be very keen on learning yet another language just to be able to benefit from using EU port. So we stayed with Verilog in this case. And the last reason why we designed it to replace the LM32 is that the design toolchain are really excellent for reducing code size, which matters a lot in deeply embedded applications. What do we want to achieve in this project? We target only FPGAs. We don't do silicon, at least our group doesn't. That doesn't preclude using URV for silicon applications, but we focus on optimizing it to run efficiently in FPGA devices. We aim to be vendor independent, but we optimize for vendor specific features, for instance, embedded loop drivers, particular block memory architecture, and other features provided by the FPGA vendor. We don't want to run Linux. This CPU is intended for small embedded applications running as deterministically as possible with a simple execution model. So we have no MMU, no privilege modes, and a very minimum set of the control status registers. We prefer small FPGA footprint and, as I mentioned already, the determinism of code execution over performance. So we store the code in the internal FPGA RAM. We plan to add optional caches in an external memory bus, and as I mentioned before. And we want to support the C extension as soon as it's declared stable in nature. So, the design. There is nothing very ingenious here. It's a simple first-stage pipeline with two memory buses, one for the instruction fetch, another one for the instruction data. We have four stages: fetch, decode, execute, and write back. The execution is in fact distributed over the last stages. And we communicate with the external world, with the external peripheral over a wishbone bus. some implementation details. So the fetch stage is pretty standard. Then in register fetch and we go work stages work in parallel, mostly PGA managers have one cycle of the latency they are registered and go around that. The decode stage also deals with the data hazards. Since the memory block for the register file is registered, has the one cycle latency, we need two bypass paths, one of the first execute stage, the second one of the second execute stage, and write back. The D stage also is also the hazard divisions. We support division and multiply all the instructions, although some of them can be emulated to save on the resources. So the baseline is only the multiply instruction, and multiply hash, divide, and remainder are emulated to exception handling. Branches are evaluated in the execute stage and the third stage, so the branches that are taken take three cycles, branches that are not taken have no penalty, just one cycle. And we applied some extra optimization, actually design trade-offs to achieve modest FPGA area and still good performance in terms of clock frequency. So the results of the low multiply and shift instructions are not bypassed. This might look like a performance bottleneck, but in fact, with the today's compilers, guys from Berkeley did an excellent job at porting GCC to RISC-V. RISC-V is up, so with the instruction scheduling performed by the GCC, the internal conditions are very seldom asserted. Some performance figures. We synthesized it on a couple of FPGA platforms. Transcom and Spartan 6, together with 64 kilobytes of RAM and simple UART and general purpose IO port, fits into a bit more than 1,000 loops, achieving 100 megahertz. In case of Altera, the design is a bit bigger because the loop has less inputs, and also we mostly work with Xilinx, so I lack a bit of the in-depth knowledge of Altera architecture. We managed to run Hallmark. The core is slightly more performant than its competitors, but this result should be taken with a bit of margin, since the compiler versions are different and certain new versions of GCC, the instruction scheduling and optimization performance is really much better. So we get the score around 240. It was 2.5 when GCC was turned on, was set up to handle every loop in the former, resulting in a pretty big code size. So the status. We published the Verilog sources for the licensed under RGPL version 3. The design is proven in the FPGA. We verify the correctness of the RP32IM instruction set. It also runs Hallmark. In the nearest future, we plan to add JTAG and debugging units. We plan to implement the compressed instruction extension. We plan to add caches that will communicate with the external memory controller over either pipeline wishbone or AXI port. Last but not least, add an FPU for digital signal processing sensitive applications. And well, the real reason is we wanted to take weights, but it can be put in an official statement. Yeah. Thank you very much. So I encourage you to join the project, have a look at it on the Open Health Repository. I brought a little demo. So showing so it's basically a display adapter and controller for inside the base that uses the URV as its CPU. Okay, this connector is a bit delicate. So
I'm sure that working. Yeah, okay. So except the RISC-V course has a smaller discount, but actually my experience is the opposite. The operator tends to be about 10% smaller.
How do you compare it? You mean in terms of code size or in terms of energy footprint?
Oh no, I mean code size, in terms of the compiled binary.
That's quite opposite to what I found out. But
GCC
version.
Yeah. I'm sure we use the same on 32 GCC version.
5.4.5.3. Five,
just check.
Well, in any case,
yeah,
I tried to get
exactly, yeah.
I wanted to do a really fair comparison of the code size of LAN32 and the RISC-V by compiling it using the same GCC version. I tried to build CoreMark, and I built CoreMark using GCC 5.2.0 for the RISC-V architecture, and unfortunately, the code didn't work. It didn't pass the checking of the integrity of the test data. So either there is a bug in the GCC or bug in my code, but the L32 port of GCC looks quite outdated.
Yeah,
and the code generator is really simplistic compared to
the modern GCC does way better, I totally agree, but and I am comparing different GCC versions. I have GCC 5 for the RISC-V, and it's the one that's on there. But my other question was, had 2k LUTs for the micro RISC. How much is the L32 on the same chip? It's about the same, isn't it? That instruction like that?
Slightly larger.
Slightly larger.
Just 10-15%.
Right.
But you know, the main concern is not,
yeah,
is not the size. So we have 200 LUTs less or more, it's the license that we have.
Yeah, I'm just a bit curious because this presentation sounds very much like the Espresso core that was made for RISC. Have you heard of that?
Yeah, I've seen it. I never tried it. Is Espresso the small speech pipeline or the big one?
That was the original implementation.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it looks pretty similar. Different ISA though. And I don't know, I think everybody who's adopting RISC-V these days, this might be a bit controversial, but I do think it's the right choice for the American RISC, so, I don't know. that looks similar, just good. Why did you never consider open RISC over LM32, actually? That's probably my question.
It was not an effect of any profound study, it was just, oh, there is RISC-V. Let's try
implementing.
Anyway,
it doesn't
really matter. Your response to
the
logo. Just a quick question. You haven't yet implemented JTAG or debug. How are you getting your programs to that?
Simply by initializing the FPGA route.
Oh, right, okay, so you have to rebuild
every
time.
There is also a bootloader that works over your.
I just noticed you put it out on an LGPL license. Can you explain what you think that means, by the way? What was your intent?
You want to have a talk about this?
There's a talk on Sunday.
There is a talk about this on Sunday, which in fact will only, give our understanding and put these open questions on the table to follow by a debate. Because
what was your intent?
The intent is weak copyleft. The intent is if you change it and you publish it, please keep sharing. And if you change the rest of the design, no need to share that. It's weak copyleft. That was the intent.
Are your slides online?
Not yet.
As a slides on that.
I'm going to touch on that.